Hello and welcome. In the previous few lessons, you learned the basics of Swift programming, and I showed you how those concepts apply to your Xcode project. Now let's get back to SwiftUI and views. Specifically, today I want to talk about the button view. Now before we dive in, just in case you're new around here, hi, my name is Chris and welcome to Code with Chris, the place to be if you want to learn how to make an app. Now I have a fun question for you. When did you discover Code with Chris and how long have you been learning with me? I've been doing this for 8 years and yet it doesn't feel that long. Let me know by leaving a quick comment below, and on your way down there, please give this video a thumbs up. It really helps me out. Thank you so much. All right, with that said, let's dive right in. All right, so I've got a brand new SwiftUI project here. I thought we would take a look at creating some button instances in a fresh project together before we go back to the war card game to use the button instance there. So let's go ahead and delete this text view right here and create some button instances. A button is a structure just like that text was, and we need to create a button instance. In other words, we need to instantiate a button. That's just another way of saying it. So let's go ahead and type button followed by opening a left rounded bracket, and that's going to bring up our autocomplete menu. There are a couple of different initializer methods we can use to create a button instance. And these initializer methods, remember, are just different ways of creating an instance while passing in some data. Two of the most common ones that you're going to be using is this one right here, where you pass in a string. And this data type string protocol just means anything that conforms to that string protocol, and a piece of text does. This one will allow you to just pass in a piece of text to use as the button label. And it will also allow you to pass in a block of code to run when that button is tapped on. So let's take a look at these parameters in more detail. So this first parameter for the label of the button is pretty straightforward. Here you just pass in a piece of text. I am going to call this button click me. And if we update, actually our preview won't do anything yet before we specify the second parameter. The data type for this action parameter is something that you haven't seen yet, but it kind of looks like a function signature without the function name, right? This is called a closure. And simply put, you can think of it as a block of code or like a function without the function name. You pass in a block of code as a parameter, and when the button is tapped on, it's going to run that block of code. Again, this is called a closure. So let's take a look at how we can specify the closure as a parameter. Now, one of the easiest things you can do is you can highlight this parameter and just hit enter. And Xcode is going to automatically open up a closure for you to type your block of code in. But I'm not going to do that right now because I want to go through the steps and really break it down to you and show you what exactly you're specifying. And then at the end, I'll show you what happens when you do hit enter and just let Xcode open the closure for you. Let's specify that closure manually for now. All right, so the type of closure that this expects is the simplest type that you can see. It accepts no parameters. These two brackets right here, these two rounded brackets, that is a parameter list, just like you would have when you're declaring a function, but it's empty. So there are no parameters. And then next you see a dash followed by a greater than symbol. And you know that that means return type, right? And it returns void. Void means nothing. So it doesn't return anything and it doesn't accept anything. It's very simply a block of code. All right, so now that you know the type of function that it's expecting, let's go ahead and specify it. So I'm going to delete that, and I'm going to open up a pair of curly brackets. Now I don't need to return anything. I don't need to specify any parameters. It's very simply just a block of code. So you can specify that with just a set of curly brackets. And in between those curly brackets, you put any code statements you want. So I am going to just print out hello world. And that is your completed button. Let's run this project and see what happens. Okay, so we have a button in the middle that says click me. When I tap on it, it runs the closure. It runs the code in the closure. And you can see that in down there in the console, it does print out Hello World every time I click this button. All right, now let's go back to our Xcode project because that's only one way to instantiate a button. I'm going to add a comment here and call this button instance with closure. Okay, and then I'm also going to put this inside of a VStack. Actually, I'm going to show you a shorthand, a cool way to do it. I'm going to put it inside of VStack because I want to show you a couple of other ways to create buttons. So we're going to create a couple of buttons together. Go ahead and command click on this button, and you can just simply choose embed in VStack. When you do that, it puts the element into a VStack for you, although it failed to move my comment there. So let's put that right there. All right. So we've got one button, and I want to show you the same button, but with a shorthand. There's something called a trailing closure. Let me show you what that means. So button instance with trailing closure. I am going to copy and paste the button we just declared and create another copy of it. So if in a parameter list, the last parameter expects a closure, there is a shorthand. And how it works is you take that last parameter out of the parameter list and you simply put the closure after the method call. Let me show you what I mean. So in this parameter list, the closure is that last parameter, right? So this is a prime candidate for a trailing closure shortcut. I take the closure itself. So I'm gonna cut this out of the parameter list, and I am simply gonna add a space after the ending rounded bracket. And then just paste the closure like that. And then I can go ahead and remove the parameter label or the argument label out of that parameter list like that. And these two button declarations are exactly the same thing. It's just that they are written differently. One is specifying the closure inside the parameter list, and the other one is specifying it using a trailing closure. And this is why I wanted to show you this manually instead of just letting Xcode open a closure for you, because when you let Xcode do it, it's going to recognize that that closure parameter is the last one, and it's going to turn it into a trailing closure for you automatically. So let me show you that. If I declare another button, let's use the same one, click me, and then I tap on that action parameter, and I either double click it or I hit enter and let Xcode open up the closure, it automatically changes it into a trailing closure. So I thought that would be really confusing for you if you'd never seen that before. And so at least now you know what a trailing closure is and why, you know, Xcode does this for you. Okay, so that is just creating one type of button. Both of these ways are to create buttons where you just have a piece of text as the label. But what if you wanted your button to be an image or, you know, an icon or something like that, not just a simple piece of text? Well, there is another initializer method for the button that we can use for that. So let's take a look at that. Button instance with label view. So let's go ahead, type button, open up a bracket, and now let's take a look at this other initializer method with an action and label parameter. Creates a button that displays a custom label. And you can see from the parameter list that the first, let me go back to that autocomplete menu. Taking a look at this parameter list, now you can see that this action closure parameter is the first parameter. And then the second parameter is a label. Now for this label parameter, you can return any view that you want to represent your button. So let's go ahead and choose this initializer method. You can see for the action closure right here, if I double click it, it's not going to change into a trailing closure. And the reason for that is because it's not the last parameter in the parameter list. So that doesn't qualify to be turned into a trailing closure. Okay, so when this button is tapped, again, I am just going to print out Hello World into the console. But for the label, you'll notice that I have some freedom to specify what sort of view I want to return. So here it's just returning a text view with a simple piece of text here called button. but I can return an image view, for example. I could return a stack of different views. You can return anything you want. Let me just resume the preview here so you can see the different buttons we've declared. Okay. So what I am going to return here is maybe let's return an H stack. And I'm going to return a text that says edit. And I'm also going to return an image in front of that. And for this image, I'm going to specify, I haven't added any images to our asset library, but I'm going to use something called an SFSymbol. Now, we haven't gone through SFSymbols yet. We will do so in a future lesson. However, SFSymbols are great because they're basically an icon set that comes with Xcode that you can just use in your apps. And there are very special features of these SFSymbols that we will go through in a future lesson in this course. There is a free Mac app called SFSymbols that you can download where you can browse all of the different symbols that are available to you for free. So for example, I'm just going to use this pencil one. Each of these has a name, which you can simply specify and you'll be able to use it. So for the image, the initializer to use, if you want to use SFSymbols, is called system name, and then you specify the name which you saw underneath the icon, the pencil. I'm just going to put pencil right there, and you can see that the icon appears. All right, so now let's run this app in the simulator and take a look at what happens. Okay, so I can tap this one, it says hello world. Tap that one, it says hello world. Tap this one, it also says hello world. Those are the closures that I specified for all of the buttons. All right, now you know how to specify a simple button with just the text for its label. You know how to specify a button which you can use any view as the button. We're going to go back to our war card game now and turn that deal button image into an actual button. All right, so now I have the war card game that we were working on all the way back in, was it lesson 4 or 5? But this is where we got to. And if you remember, we had used an image for this deal button. And this is the view code for that. You can see that it's just an image. Now you know how to turn this into a button. So I want you to just pause the video right now and try it on your own in your own project, just as a little exercise. After you've tried it out for yourself, or if you just got stuck, continue playing this video and we'll do it together. Okay, let's try it out together. So I am going to just create a little bit of space here, and we are going to declare a button using a button. Let's open up brackets and let's choose this action label initializer method. Now inside the action, we're just going to open up that block of code, but we're not really going to do anything yet. We will do that in the next lesson. But for the label, instead of a text button label, and delete that view, and I'm simply going to move our image with the deal button into the label for our button. And just like that, you can't really see any visual change. But however, if you run this in the simulator, then you will notice that you can tap it. It's an actual button. Another way, if you don't want to launch your simulator, is you can hit this button right here for the live preview, and after it gets started, yeah, then you can go ahead and I have to hit resume on that. Okay, you can see now in the canvas, because I have live preview turned on, I can test out the button. That was your first introduction to handling user interaction in a Swift UI app. The pieces are really coming together. Let's do a quick recap. You learned how to instantiate buttons, and that's just a fancy way of saying creating button instances. You learned about closures and how they're just blocks of code, like functions without a function name. And then you learned about trailing closures, which are just a shorthand. And just to remind you, A trailing closure is when you have a closure as a parameter in a method call, and then it gets taken out of that parameter list and instead is put at the end of that method call. Now, to make sure you really understand all of these things, make sure you do the quiz and attempt the challenge. You can get all of these resources at codewithchris.com and just hit the try for free button or sign into your account and then enroll in the 14-day beginner challenge. Now, if you enjoyed this lesson, please give it a thumbs up and make sure you're subscribed and that you've got bell notifications turned on so you don't miss the next lesson. In the next lesson, I'm going to show you a key SwiftUI concept that is going to allow you to change data and have the UI automatically detect the change and then update the UI by itself. All right, I'll see you in the next lesson.